All right, welcome back. When it comes to the fight against radical Islam, our next guest calls it the war of our time, and he's outlined a number of steps that he would take as president. But of course, first, Jeb Bush needs to win the Republican nomination and then the general election, and he is in studio this morning. Governor, good to see you, sir.
Great being with you.
Yeah, obviously, very serious and big week as far as the news is concerned in foreign policy. And you said that you would take some aggressive steps in the war on Islam and radical Islam and ISIS. Kind of outline this for us.
Yeah, well, so ISIS has declared war on us, and we've not declared war on them. And the net result is a caliphate the size of Indiana that garners strength by its existence. And they intend to continue to create real instability and attack Europe. And I believe they're planning to attack the United States. We need to aggressively confront them. And this president and the Democratic frontrunner both believe that it's a law enforcement exercise rather than an act of war. The United States leadership is necessary to forge a coalition to take them out. We can't just be in the air. We have to be leading with ground troops, mobilizing local folks that have been left behind because we've not provided support. We need to garner the support of the Arab world, and we need to garner the support of Europe, and we
sure
can do this.
How many troops are we talking about, and where do you send them?
So, well, first of all, you don't put constraints on the military. You ask them what the best what the best strategies are to achieve the objective, which is the annihilation of ISIS. So I don't have a number. But you can't do it just from the air, for sure. And you need to make sure that you do this in unison with the local forces that are prepared to fight. They just want to know the United States is going to be in the game. They're going to be serious, that we're going to lead, that we're going to provide training, we're going to provide air support. There should be a no-fly zone in Syria. We need safe zones in Syria. We need to arm the Kurds in Iraq. We need to do a whole wide variety of things to achieve the military objective and politically create security for the region so you don't create another breeding ground of Islamic terrorists that will once again create instability in the region and attack the West.
Yeah, you know, a couple of weeks ago, Madeleine Albright was in here. It didn't seem like it was all that long ago she was Secretary of State, but boy, do we live in a different world. This isn't Saddam Hussein we're talking about or Muammar Gaddafi in Libya. These are shadowy figures in the four corners of the globe. I mean, where do you go? I mean, where do you start when it comes to fighting ISIS?
You start where their strength is. You start in Iraq and Syria, where they have 30 to 40,000 battle-tested terrorists that are organizing and garnering financial support, recruiting people each and every day from the West as well as from the region. You start there, mm-hmm. and that's how you cut the head off. And if you don't do that, then you're going to see instability in the region, and you're going to see continued attacks against Europe and the United States. This is a serious undertaking, and this president has not led. He has treated it as though that it's some law enforcement exercise. He's put constraints on the military, and the net result is we've had a dismal failure here, and anybody that disagrees with him ends up being a warmonger or ends up being, you know, he just has this petulant attitude. Instead of having a dialogue, I've created a strategy 3 months ago. He claims that people that oppose his policies don't. And it's with the advice of a lot of really strong military advisors, we can do this. He knows it, but he doesn't want to lead.
What do people not understand about this faith, this group, and what motivates them? A lot of people think, you know, these are a bunch of young people, adventure seeking, getting caught up in the wrong business. But
look,
other people,
John Kerry this week said something incredibly unfortunate, which was that you could understand how they, because of their grievances, how they might attack France, but this last attack was couldn't understand it. Well, you can't understand terrorists that way. You can't think that way about them. They're organizing to destroy freedom, Western civilization. That's not a dramatic statement. That's a fact. Sometimes you have to take them at their word, and then you create strategies and policies to recognize that. And there's nothing too complex about this. They want to go back to a fifth century world. Their ideology is one to destroy the West, to destroy our freedoms. They oppose all this, and our freedom becomes our weakness unless we act.
One of the side effects of all this, obviously, the mass migration that's taking place, there's
yeah.
debate going on right now about how many the U.S. should accept, if any at all, what kind of vetting process they should go through. What's your take on the U.S.'s role when it comes to
that? I think there should be a thorough vetting process, and it ought to be explained to the American people. Right now, the president's administration hasn't given any information about how they're going to go about doing this. And given the fact that this refugee situation is so unique, you could have, as was the case in Paris, embedded terrorists with refugees that are seeking safety, we have to be really cautious. But there are cases, I think, where you could clearly make the case of persecuted Christians, for example. They're not going to be Islamic terrorists. By their nature, they're the ones that are being beheaded, being persecuted, being enslaved. There are cases where I think the United States should act. But clearly, this administration, who created the refugee crisis by not leading 3 years ago, by grandiose language of the red line and all these things, now for them to lecture people that are opposed to their policy, I find it hypocritical beyond belief. They created the crisis by inaction, and now they're saying that we must take everybody and shame on us for not having compassion. Well, the best compassion would be to destroy the cause of the refugee crisis, which is Assad's brutality and ISIS's barbaric actions. 3 to 4 million refugees have left Syria in camps around region, and now increasing 800,000 to Europe. This is a serious international crisis, and our president has not led.
One question I want to ask you, Louisiana Governor Bobby Jindal, former presidential candidate, very upset this week when he found out that refugees from that region were already in his state and he wasn't notified. They came through Catholic Charities, I think, or one of the other resettlement agencies. Do you think the possibility exists that the leak is already broken, so to speak, that we gotta start looking inward?
That's why the administration needs to press the pause button, right. Explain exactly what the situation is. Most refugees, the process takes 1 to 2 years. So I'd be surprised if there's a large number of people. But whatever it is, there should be clarity about this. This is a national security concern. And I think Congress has the right to hold the administration to account on this.
Yeah, let's talk about the campaign a little bit. We only have a couple more minutes to go. But downsized your campaign a couple of weeks ago, put more of an emphasis on New Hampshire. How are things going?
Great. They're going fantastic. And we didn't downsize in the sense of we reallocated towards the early states, which I enjoy because I'm going to be here a lot more. I love campaigning in New Hampshire, and we're spending a lot of time in South Carolina and Iowa. And I think it's going pretty good, to be honest with you.
How do you change the narrative, though? And you could tell reporters to stop asking the question, but sure, I get it. But obviously, you need to have a moment. You need to something's got to turn as far as the momentum.
Yeah, so you know New Hampshire political history better than anybody else. Most people make up their mind. More than half the voters make up their mind in the last 10 days. I'm all in. I'm campaigning. We're gonna have town hall meetings each and every time I come here, a multitude of them. And the cumulative effect of campaigning hard, showing my heart, explaining what my life experience is about, showing that I'm the most, on that stage, I'm the most proven conservative reformer that has gotten the greatest results. With the cumulative effect of that, I think puts me in a good position.
When you look at New Hampshire, you look at the Iowa caucuses and in the early states, and we talked about the process a little bit before, but there's some that believe that it needs to change, like a regional primary, perhaps a lottery system or rotation or something like that. Why do you think this is the right way? And I'm not asking you to blow smoke towards New Hampshire or Iowa, but...
I will, though.
Sure.
I mean, look, here's what I've learned by being a candidate. The voters of Iowa, and the most particularly the voters of New Hampshire, are the most discerning voters because they take their position really with a lot of responsibility. They take it seriously. I've had people come to my town hall meetings like 6, 7, 8 times. They're still trying to figure out who they're going to support.
Right.
And that doesn't happen in other places. I think that's why these states should be first. And I think after that, maybe you could have regional primaries. I don't know. I think it should be a tough process because we're electing a commander-in-chief and the leader of the free world, someone who has to make tough decisions. And the campaign should be tough because of that. It's going to be a lot tougher being president with the mess that we have in Washington, D.C. right now. And sure. So I love campaigning here, and I think it's proper that we maintain the first in the nation primary status for New Hampshire.
Lastly, do you think there's anything you as a candidate need to do better, or that you would like to improve on, or do you think it's just all about hammering away and keep
working
hard?
I get better each and every day. I have enough self-awareness to know that I can always improve. I don't view this as I don't have a huge ego. I'm a grinder. When I see things that I need to do better, I work hard to improve them for sure.
All right. Well, best of luck to you moving
Thanks.
Forward. And we expect to see a lot of you.
Oh, yeah.
About 7, 8, 9, 10 weeks. I don't know. It's coming sometime soon. Governor, good to see you. Thanks very much. We